Good morning, Faith Church. Each Easter joy to each of you. We are thrilled you're here. It brings us incredible joy. We had a collection of folks that were at the Shelter House at 7 a.m. this morning. Lori graced us with a gracious, beautiful song. The sun was rising right as she was singing. It was a glorious moment. Now, my fingers were numb. And our toes were cold, but you couldn't leave the beauty of the moment. And I want to thank everybody for being a part of that and our Easter breakfast today. What a day indeed. Kim and I had the opportunity to attend the Easter service with our daughter up at her church, the church she attends. And one phrase that really captured my attention was this: Easter is not an event. Easter and resurrection is a person. Resurrection is not just an event, it's a person. In fact, Jesus himself said it in John 11:25, I am the resurrection and the life. Amen. Well, it's our hope and prayer that you encounter the risen Christ even as we worship in these moments. Before we get to a much anticipated organ piano duet, allow me to highlight a few things, the first of which I don't want to forget. My wife and I are actually going to be gone next weekend. Dustin is going to be filling in for me. If you remember, he's an awesome preacher and will deliver a wonderful message. Well, he's doing that down at Hope Church, too, which means we need help with the breakfast. Now, we're doing a breakfast. We have good breakfast. He'll be there to get it started, but then he needs to be down at Hope to share there. So if you're able to step in and help us with that next Sunday during the meal or the breakfast time, we would much appreciate it. And while I'm putting a line out there for help, Faith Cafe continues this coming week and we need bakers. So if you're able to bake something for our Faith Cafe, as you know, we try our best to do homemade goodies and pastries and all that. And we look forward to some of the things that we will provide, so keep that in mind. Also want to highlight our Revelation study. We have over 20 people now signed up to be a part of that, both churches, Faith and Hope. We're offering it, as you know, here on Monday nights at 7 and Wednesday mornings at Hope. And there's a sign-up list. It's not too late to get involved, but we need to know ASAP. Again, we have a whole contingent of folks being a part of that. You can read about that in the bulletin. We continue, as you notice in the bulletin over these weeks, receiving an offering for the people of Ukraine, and especially for the refugees, now 4.5 million strong, who are trying to make a way in some of the neighboring countries. So keep that in mind in our offering of the day. And now to a much anticipated moment, our piano and organ duet, and the well-familiar piece, the stunning piece that Hallelujah was.
Thank you.
praising God. But I'd be curious, how much practice did that take to put all that together? I'm just curious. A little bit. Hours.
Well,
hours.
And I think I told you that this was my mom's music. In high school, she played this part and I played that part.
Okay.
This is the first time that we have done it together.
Oh, my goodness. I didn't know that.
Yes.
Wow. It was a privilege. And doesn't that stir soaring emotions in our hearts? Amen. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Let's stand and share our call to worship of today as we celebrate our worship. The stone has been rolled away.
The grave of the Lord is lying in.
The body is gone.
Mary's weeping is halted by the man's questions.
Why are you crying?
Who is it you are looking for?
Let us proclaim with Mary.
We have seen the risen Lord.
Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Amen. Let's share the first four verses of this classic Easter hymn, Christ the Lord is risen today. The news of your victory over the powers powers of death and evil is news so startling, so amazing, so different from the news that bombards us day after day after day. Beyond our comprehension, O Lord, you startle us again and again with resurrection life, bringing grace and hope and joy. You and your risen power are shaping all our days, and so we gather to praise you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen and amen. With joy in your hearts, let's pass the peace of Christ one to another with an Easter blessing. Go ahead and greet one another. Amen. I got a simple question for you. For how many of you is Easter just a very, very busy time? Is it a kind of a, just one of a few? Obviously, I'm a little busy these days, but a lot of times we get such in a hurry and a rush at Easter, we kind of just blow through it. What if we were to pause for a few minutes? Be quiet in God's presence. And allow the real meaning of Easter to sink into our pores and into our hearts. To help us along, we have a very, very brief video clip that we'd like you to just absorb. And then afterwards, no words, just a period of echo prayers in your heart that well up and rejoice in the one who came back for you.
Yeah.
thank Debbie Fields for all the beautiful flower. And you look around every corner of the sanctuary as a reminder of Easter joy and resurrection. It is amazing. Thank you, Debbie, for your offering your gifts to us. We receive our offering of the day. As you've already heard, we continue receiving our offering in support of the people of the Ukraine, but as well have the joy of sharing in the life and support and ministry of this church, seeking to make a difference in this community. So let us pray together. Lord, we are grateful for the opportunity to gather to sing our Easter hymns and hear beautiful expressions of faith like the Alleluia chorus. It stirs us, it causes us to sense a soaring in our heart and soul. We realize, though, that Easter continues well beyond the service, not merely a season, but a life. And that your resurrection, as we've named, is more than an event, but the person that you are is the Lord of life and resurrection. We present ourselves, our offering today, with a humble prayer that you would take it, bless it, multiply it. Lord, make it enough for those and the needs of those around us, that Faith Church might be your instrument in this community. We present ourselves and our offerings in your name and for your sake. In Jesus we pray. Amen. Join me in the doxology. Easter is a time of celebration and joy. Our prayer today focuses on that celebration. Let us pray together. Just God's people. Lord, we have to confess, we thought you were dead. We thought the cross was the end. We thought that when that stone rolled over the tomb, that it was all. But now we discover the dead are living, the cross is empty, the stone is rolled away, and one word describes and captures it. Alleluia. Jesus is risen. We thought you had said your final word, but those with political power had won. But that when you cried out, that was it. But the word breathes, the powers are defeated, and the final cry is only the beginning. And it wells up within us, it resonates in our heart, this word, hallelujah. 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 Jesus is risen. We thought your story was finished. We thought your hope had ended. We thought the tomb was sealed. But now we know the story has just begun. The hope is newly born. The tomb is empty. And again, that single word wells up from within. Hallelujah. 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 This is the news. Jesus is risen. This is the moment. Jesus is alive. And this is the gospel. Jesus is with us. We thought that when they crucified you, death had defeated you, and that was it. But now we know love is stronger than death, and one word captures it all. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Christ is risen. Amen. Amen. Join me in the Lord's prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom comes, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory. You're in for another treat as Lori Brown comes to share with us.
I believe in the risen one. I believe I overcome by the power of His blood. Amen. Amen. Amen.
God's people responded? Amen. Amen. Indeed. We're going to read the scripture during the message, so that will come in a moment. I'm going to begin with this. It was a woman who was looking out her back porch window when she discovered their German shepherd with their neighbor's rabbit in its mouth, shaking the life out of it. This was an added crisis because the relationship between that family and the neighbors was strained at best. As a result, she was in a panic. Yeah, got some kids, going to kids. Wonderful. Thank you, Jan, for sharing in that gift. Amen. Amen. Anyway, she was in a panic. She didn't know what in the world to do. She grabs a broom from her closet, runs across the yard, and starts pummeling her dog. Let go, let go. And finally, the dog lets go of this now very dead rabbit. And she's standing there. What do I do now? And then a flash of insight caught her. And she picks that rabbit up, races back to her house, gives it a bath, takes her blow dryer out, fluffs up its fur, combs it so it looks pretty good. She sneaks back into the neighbor's yard and puts that rabbit in the rabbit cage and sneaks back undetected. A little bit later in the afternoon, she hears this scream, and it's her neighbor. And she rushes over, what's wrong, what's wrong? And this frantic neighbor, it's my rabbit, it's my rabbit. He died 2 weeks ago and we buried him and now he's here again. People in the ancient world knew that dead rabbits tend to stay dead. They also knew that dead rabbis, likewise, tend to stay dead. Theologian N.T. Wright says this, there were many messianic movements in the first century, and in every case, the would-be messiahs are crucified by the Romans, just as they did Jesus. He goes on to say, it's not in not one single case that we hear of the slightest mention of the disappointed followers claiming their hero had been raised from the dead. Think about it. Until now. Because that's exactly what his disciples did. They claimed he had been raised from the dead. Now, these are the most unlikely witnesses you might imagine. They stumbled, they fell, they denied, they betrayed, they fled. They didn't really believe that he was going to come back to life. But then when he was there, it changed their lives and can change ours as well. There is a wide array of evidence for the resurrection, and those who struggle with that need that evidence. Countless people have sought to disprove it only to become believers themselves. All kinds of different evidence, from the empty tomb itself, to the written records, both biblical and extra-biblical, to the transformation of the disciples. One of the most compelling proofs of the resurrection is the utter change that it brought in the disciples' hearts and lives. The emergence of a brand new faith, the emergence of the church, the great divide in human history, the changed lives of people you know. It's an array of evidence that supports the reality of Jesus' resurrection. But you know, I think we need something more personal. Something more experiential. Today I want to explore a different side of Easter. You've probably never heard an Easter sermon on this. You probably never will again. It's called the emotions of Easter. It reveals the range of emotions that the gospel story elicits. And there's a story from a missionary that kind of gives us a hint into this. There's a tribe in East Asia, in the jungles of East Asia, They had never heard about Jesus, and they'd never heard or seen something on a motion picture, like on a screen. And the way they encountered both of those at the same time is priceless. It reminds me, in a way, of something I experienced. This past week, my wife and I went to visit my Aunt Phyllis. She's an Alzheimer patient at the facility in Circleville. And while her Alzheimer's is advancing, she's still pretty much a happy Alzheimer's patient. And sometimes when we visit her, she kind of knows who we are, or recognizes we're familiar to her. Well, we found her this day sitting in a little seating area watching TV with another resident. And of all things they were doing, they were watching a soap opera called The Bold and the Beautiful. Anybody ever watched The Bold and the Beautiful? Well, this particular scene was dramatic. They were in a hospital, this lady had been in an accident, she's in a coma, family members are coming in one after another, pouring out their hearts, just bearing their soul to this relative that's in a coma, hoping that she might come. And my aunt says, they're really hurting, aren't they? And then the most unusual thing happened. Look over, and there are tears running down her face. She has inserted herself, experiencing their drama as if she was part of it, as if it was real to her. And maybe it was. Well, a similar kind of thing happened to this tribe. Again, they're hearing about Jesus for the first time. They're hearing or seeing anything on a screen for the first time. Here's what happened. Imagine how it felt to see a good man, Jesus, who healed the sick and was adored by children, under trial and beaten by jeering soldiers. As they watched this, the people came, the tribesmen came unglued. They stood up and began to shout at the cruel men on the screen, demanding that this outrage stop. They just couldn't imagine that that was happening. Nothing happened. And so they thought, perhaps the guy that's operating the thing, maybe he's the cause of it, maybe he's the vile one. And so they start to attack him. The missionaries had to intervene and stop it now and said, you know, this is just the beginning of the story. Don't worry, there's more to come. And they got him quieted back down. And of course, the next part of the Jesus film was the crucifixion. And again, the people could not hold back. They began to weep and wail with such loud grief that once again, the film had to be stopped. The missionaries tried to console them and to calm them down, exhorting them, the story, it's still not done, just hold on. Well, then came the resurrection. And at that point, pandemonium broke out. This time, not in anger or rage, but in celebration. It was a far different reason. The gathering had spontaneously erupted into a party. The noise of jubilation was almost deafening. They were whistling and shouting and dancing and slapping one another and even repeating that line from the film, Christ is risen. Christ is risen. They had to shut the projector off yet again because there was just so much noise. This time, not because the story was more, there was more to the story, but simply because that's how they should respond. You see the range of emotions they experienced in that short period of time, from outrage at what was happening to this Jesus, and then the joy of discovering he's alive. It's amazing. Well, in the passage in John's Gospel, we discover this kind of emotion. We find a full range of emotion in this passage. Let me just share a little bit of those emotions that surge forward in this passage. There's numbness, stifling grief, regret, shame, confusion, and loss of orientation. Imagine the disciples. They'd been with Jesus for 3 years. They'd witnessed miracle after miracle. They'd seen his love poured out. They were firsthand witnesses of it all. And yet, when Jesus needed them the most, what did they do? One betrayed him, one denied him, most fled. There was indeed shame, regret. They thought it was over. Even though he told them, I'm going to be killed. But in 3 days, it didn't sink in. They didn't anticipate that a real resurrection was going to happen. And then it does. And they see Jesus once again face to face, which leads to yet another array of emotions. Astonishment. Wonder, joy, and urgency. Well, we see the emotions of Easter most clearly in Mary Magdalene, Mary, and especially in Mary's tears. Mary was crying not just a few tears at a difficult moment, no, Mary was weeping. Weeping from deep within her heart and soul. 2 days earlier, she had witnessed the death of the one who had rescued her from a life of darkness and terror. She had seen him put to death on a cross. No doubt his death left her confused, numb, desperate, crushed. Ever since that initial encounter when Jesus freed her, her whole life revolved around him. The gospel accounts bear witness to the fact that she had been part of his traveling followers, the company who will follow him around Galilee. Notice as well that she was one of the few who was at the foot of the cross, who endured it all from beginning to end. She had accompanied his crucified body back to Joseph's tomb in the garden. Then early Sunday morning, she had gone with a small group of women to the tomb. To their great distress and surprise, they found the stone rolled away and his body was gone. Yeah, I love that exclamation point. Thank you. And soon afterwards, Peter and John arrived on the scene only to depart and leave Mary alone in the garden, standing beside her pool of tears, we might say. Now Jesus is gone, and she weeps. Mary's emotion represents the emotions of the whole world in the presence of the cruelty of death. Folks, allow me to pause for a moment and suggest the pain of the nation of Ukraine, the pain, the agony of what they are encountering and experiencing in this war that is inflicted upon them. I think Mary's emotions resonate with their emotions face of death. I think it resonates with all of us of the cruelty of death and the cruelty of evil in our world. I think we find something we resonate with in it all. The pain and the tears are unbelievable. Well, those tears are expressions of the deep grief of her heart, revealing the intensity of her pain. Mary's tears remind us that tears are a part of humanity. I begin to wonder, if Mary were here today, what would she tell us? What would she bear witness to? What word would come from her that might help us with our own tears? The first is that, oh my goodness, be real. Be real with your tears, your own pool of tears. And that phrase comes from a seasoned pastor who once gave counsel to a young pastor beginning his ministry. Always remember that each person you see in your congregation sits next to his or her own pool of tears. You may wonder, why is the pastor talking about tears on Easter? This is a day for joy. But notice the full range of emotions on this first Easter. And it's what we experience too, isn't it? Life has a way of killing our dreams. Set out with high hopes for your schooling, your career, your family, your golden years. You have plans, aspirations, expectations. But then things don't work out that way, do they? plants fall through, people let you down, you let yourself down. And suddenly your life just isn't the way you expected it would have been or dreamed it would be. And you find yourself in a place you never expected to believe be. Folks, deep inside of us, whether you're an outward crier or an inward crier, deep inside all of us is a subterranean pool of tears. Mary would encourage us to be real with those tears. And admittedly, that's hard for us in this culture. We want to put a front on that refuses to acknowledge tears for fear that they would be seen as weaknesses. And so we hide behind the facade of being in control, having it all together. Crying, though, Mary would tell us, is probably human. What do your pool of tears represent? I'll get it for you. I don't mind. That would be a help, wouldn't it? Yeah. You probably, you know, it might be empty. Anyway. What do your tears represent? What do your tears represent? How would you finish the statement? Lord, I'm crying today because. I'm crying today because. I'm grieving today because I lost my spouse. Lord, I'm crying today because my marriage is in pain. Lord, I'm crying today because this divorce I'm going through is excruciating. Lord, I'm crying today because I've been unemployed for too many months. I'm crying today because I'm trying to break free from this addiction. I'm crying today because I'm so far away from you and I don't know how to get back. Lord, I'm crying today. Would you finish that statement? Mary was deeply aware that subterranean pool of tears. She would encourage you to name your own, embrace them, and then release them into the hands of the risen Christ. She would then say, open your hearts to the hope that's beyond the tears. Trevor Hudson, South African pastor, says this: allow Easter morning to deepen your belief that on the other side of your brokenness, your grief, your pain, your loss, lies the possibility of new beginnings. On one hand, you could look at your tears and give in to anguish and despair, but on the other hand, you could see them as God's way into your heart and life, into the hope of transformation. Resurrection and tears are often interwoven. Tears may well be the best pathway God has into your heart and soul. Allow your tears to be that very pathway Christ walks into your life. Listen to the scripture when Jesus asks Mary, dear woman, why are you crying? Why are you crying? Jesus asks, who are you looking for? Thought he was the gardener at that point. Sir, if you've taken him away, tell me where you've put him and I will go and get him. And then one word changed the entire horizon of her life. Do you know what that word was? He called out her name. Mary. She heard that name. And it had called her from death to life years ago. And that name had forever been etched in her mind and heart. And when she heard it again, she knew it was not the gardener, that she was he was Jesus. She turned and cried out to him, Rabboni, teacher. There are a few scenes more powerful in the Gospels. In her weeping, Jesus touches her. The voice restores her. She hears that voice, Mary. She's brought back from death to life. Imagine for a moment if you were in the garden that day. Imagine you hearing your own name. Hearing your name called by the risen Christ. yes, we need evidences for the resurrection. We're well and good, they're important. But we also need an encounter with the risen Christ, personally. We need to experience for ourselves that voice calling our name. And when we hear it, our hearts are open to unspeakable joy. Open your heart to unspeakable joy. As we explore the emotions of Easter, I believe Mary here is experiencing the purest joy any human could ever experience. And the realization that her Savior, who she once thought was dead, is now calling her name alive and rescuing her. Listen to a passage that Jesus shared with his disciples few chapters earlier in John's Gospel. I'll tell you the truth, you will weep and mourn over what is going to happen to me, but the world will rejoice. You will grieve, but your grief will suddenly turn to wonderful joy. It will be like a woman suffering in the pains of labor when her child is born. Her anguish gives way to joy because she has brought a new baby into the world. So you have sorrow now, but I will see you again, and you will rejoice, and no one can rob you of that joy. Folks, there is no greater joy than when Jesus touches us at that point of our deepest tears. There is joy that Jesus is alive to bring help and healing and grace and mercy just at that point. Folks, that is possible for you. It's possible here. It's possible today, and it's possible. J.R.R. Tolkien. How many of you know who he is? Anybody seen the Lord of the Rings trilogy? He was a devoted Christian. And he coined a word that captures the essence of this joy. He called it eucatastrophe. You can advance the slides a bit. Eucatastrophe. Let me describe a little bit of how he describes it. It brings unbelievable joy. He says these stories have always had a certain kernel to them. They're always an incredibly hopeless situation, a victory snatched out of the jaws of defeat, but how through someone who comes in to rescue the woman who defeats, who turns defeat into victory. He says it's the kind of stories that seem to bring us the deep kind of joy, and he coined this word, eucatastrophe. Well, we know what the word catastrophe is. Do you know what the word eucatastrophe is? A joyful catastrophe. And that's exactly what Easter is. It awakens us to unspeakable joy through intense pain. But Mary would tell us one more thing. We think we're done with the story, but we're not quite. We haven't fully experienced Easter. We haven't fully encountered the risen Christ until we hear Jesus say, go and tell others. Go and tell others. There is urgency woven through this entire passage. It ramps up the emotions. Mary and the disciples are running back and forth. And there's even an emotional charge in what Mary shares with the disciples. I have seen the Lord. I have to confess, I think we as a church have lost this urgency today. And maybe it's a sure sign we need a fresh encounter with the risen Christ. As we meet him, we too will be running to tell others. And you know, when we meet Jesus at that place of deepest vulnerability, at the place of our tears, he touches us there, we do have a story to tell. In fact, maybe the very best place to begin is right there. Maybe the witness you need to bring is simply sharing your tears with another. Maybe if you share your story and how Jesus met you at that place of your brokenness, your pain, your loss, it may encourage another person to encounter the risen Christ themselves. Tears can become radiant tears. We have a member at Hope Church. She's gone through more health challenges than you can imagine. The most recent, another bout with cancer, not her first. She's been on the threshold of death countless times. And she said this morning, "I could not help not be here today. I had to be here today." Tears flowing down her face because she wanted to share Easter with her community of faith. And I told her, "Jan, your tears are radiant. Your tears are radiant. They lift us all up. May your tears be radiant. And may your joy be unspeakable." Let us pray together. Lord, we would rather hide our tears, the pain behind them. We don't want people to think we're out of sorts, out of control, weak. And so we live behind the facade of having it all together. But you know, as Mary knows, that inside each and every one of us, there is a subterranean pool of tears. That you've been raised from the dead to reach, to touch, and to heal. Help us to open our hearts to that hope. Even today, here and now. For your sake we pray. Amen. Let's stand and sing this great hymn of faith, "Up from the grave he arose." And I'm going to turn my mic off because I'm going to sing loud. You'll appreciate that gift. But I invite you to sing it with all your heart this morning with passion.
Thank you.
I said, Easter is not an event, it's a person. A person who reminds us when he says, I am the resurrection and the life. May you hear his voice call your name today. Amen. Amen. Let's sing, go down and pray.